To be proud.
You should be.
Yeah.
Play hard. We're supposed to win.
They were bigger, stronger, faster.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Please rise for the invocation by Reverend David Roberts. Morning Star First Baptist.
Evening, let us pray. Most gracious and all-wise God, great creator of the universe, great creator of all the earth, we thank you right now for giving us life, health, and strength. We appreciate the opportunity to come together to meet about issues concerning the great citizens of this great city. We ask right now that you allow us to come together under the guidance and the anointing of your Holy Spirit, that every decision that we make, everything that we deliberate upon, we consider all of your children. For truly we are all of your children. Be with us now. Allow us to agree to disagree, but allow us to come together and make a decision that's going to benefit all of mankind. So I pray in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, we have a lot of distinguished guests here tonight, some all the way from Raleigh representing the Wildlife Commission, and our state representative, Mr. Jay Adams, Judge Burford Cherry, oh, there he is, hey Burford, and I'm leaving some people out, so I'll stop right there. Some other people are going to get introduced in a few minutes. The occasion is that we're going to have the swearing in of some folks, and we'll get into that in a few minutes. But it occurred to me that that we had, at this point, I feel more Hickory representatives in Raleigh, in various boards and commissions, than perhaps we ever had. And then I'm going to mess this up, but I think I'm going to talk about the people who are appointed to Raleigh boards and commissions. Some people are appointed by the governor to local positions, such as Catawba Valley Community College. But Tom Atkins serves on the Crime Commission. David Clark serves on the Food Manufacturing Task Force. Kurt Jacuz serves on the Health Coordinating Council. James Young serves on Hearing Aid Dealers and Fitters. Martin Fall serves in Human Resources. Richard Thompson serves Juvenile Justice Planning Committee. Yours truly is on the Local Government Commission. Deborah Bolick is on the Medical Board. Clem Geithner is on the North Carolina Center for Advancement of Teaching. Judy Greenhill is on the Real Estate Commission. Lou Wetmore is the our local representative on the Department of Transportation. And Dave Leonetti's on the Youth Advisory Council. So we have quite a lot of appointees doing a great job of representing our interests in Raleigh. With that, I'm going to ask our state representative, Jay Adams, to come to, I guess you're going to step to the podium there. And Jay is going to lead the next part of the program.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, council members. It's a special night on a number of levels. And I want to just articulate the underlying basis for what these gentlemen will be dealing with. You may have heard of the public trust doctrine. I put a document on your desk for you to look at. Public trust doctrine became an issue late in the session this year. And what it is it's about wildlife. Public trust doctrine is recognized as an essential foundation of what has been termed the North American model of wildlife conservation. Simply defined, a trust is a collection of assets committed or entrusted to one to be managed or cared for in the interest of another. The party to whom the trust assets are committed is commonly referred to as the trustee, whereas the party to whom the assets are being managed is referred to as a beneficiary of the trust. Accordingly, the public trust doctrine holds that publicly owned wildlife resources are entrusted to the government as trustee of these resources to be managed on behalf of the public, the beneficiaries. Consequently, governmental institutions do not own trust resources. Rather, they are owned by the public and are entrusted in the care of the government to be safeguarded for the public's long-term benefit. In 1939, Western North Carolina didn't have much in the way of wildlife resources. And a group of people locally came together in March of 1939 and formed what was called the Catawba County Wildlife Club. And the purpose was conservation of wildlife resources and protection of the environment for these wildlife resources. The early members of that club, that organization, were instrumental a few years later in the formation of the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission. Not many people really realize Catawba County's, you know, participation in this. What we're doing tonight is really a part of that legacy of wildlife protection and conservation that really Catawba County and Hickory had a lot to do with. And so this is a special night for me to bring forth two absolutely perfectly qualified people to be on this commission. The commission is comprised of 19 members, and I think that it's unprecedented. Nobody has told me otherwise that two members of the commission be from a single city. So it's very special to have two members on the commission. I've known Dean Proctor for a long time, hunted with Dean. I know what a worker bee he is. I've known Mike Johnson, I think, since the day he moved here. Mike has been, he's an outdoorsman, he's a hunter and a fisherman. He's also taught countless hunter safety courses. So we have some very special assets here, people. It's important to me also that this opens a door for these people to connect with folks in Raleigh and to open more doors for people from Hickory and from Catawba County to go and serve in Raleigh. This is a big duty. When I called Mike and said, Mike, would you be interested in doing this? He said, absolutely. And I said, there are two ways we can do this. There's a speaker's appointment, it's for 2 years. And there's a governor's appointment for 6 years. And he agreed to go for the 6-year appointment. That's a huge commitment, folks. Huge commitment. I'm only committed to two, you're only committed to four. He's committed to six. So Dean was also willing to put his name in the basket for appointment from the speaker, so he's on for 2 years. So these guys will do a wonderful job. The next part of this, I asked Burford Chief District Court Judge Burford Cherry to do the swearing in. And it's special for me that he does this because he's the guy who sponsored me into the Catawba Valley Wildlife Club over 25 years ago. So all of this is part of a legacy thing to me, and it gives me great pleasure to invite Burford to do the swearing in for these two gentlemen.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Jay's a good friend of mine. Don't hold that against me, please. You place your left hand on the Bible here. Proctor, if you put your left hand on the Bible, patiently raise your right, please.
I state your name.
I, Michael A. Johnson.
Do solemnly swear. That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
I state your name.
I, Michael A. Johnson.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will be faithful and bear true allegiance.
That I will be faithful and bear true allegiance
to the state of North Carolina.
To the state of North Carolina.
And to the constitutional powers and authorities.
And to the constitutional powers and authorities.
Which are or may be established.
Which are or may be established.
For the government thereof.
For the government thereof.
And that I will endeavor to support, maintain, and defend.
That I will endeavor to support, maintain, and defend.
The Constitution of said state.
The Constitution of said state.
Not inconsistent with the Constitution of the United States.
Not inconsistent with the Constitution of the United States.
I state your name.
I, Michael A. Johnson.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will well and truly execute.
That I will well and truly execute.
The duties of my office.
The duties of my office.
As a member of the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission.
As a member of the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission.
According to the best of my skill and ability.
According to the best of my skill and ability.
According to law.
According to law.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Gentlemen, congratulations.
Thank you, Judge.
Mr. Mayor, if you will probably excuse Mike and myself, we have a meeting in the morning, first meeting of the Wildlife Commission, 7:30 in Raleigh.
Okay.
Thank you.
You guys need speed.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you all. Thank
Appreciate you. They're just here to escort.
Yeah, they're going to escort.
Take care of you guys.
And the chief's in here. He can.
Whatever you say.
I'm going to ask our auditors to come forward, and they will be presenting the comprehensive annual financial report.
Good evening. My name is Paula Hodges, and I'm an audit partner for Martin Starnes and Associates. And I'm pleased to be here this evening to present the audited financial statements for the city for June 30, 2015. I've prepared a brief presentation for you that highlights information from your audited financial statements and just points out what we feel like is the most important. So we'll go ahead and get started. Our audit opinion was unmodified. And what that means is the city received a clean audit opinion. There were no areas in which our staff and members of management of the city could not agree as it relates to the information that's in your audited financial statements. Now, our audit is a lengthy process, and we come on site and ask a lot of questions, and we request a lot of information, and we found the city staff to be cooperative, and we would just like to thank them for their assistance. The city's general fund, or operating fund, had an unassigned fund balance that increased $516,000. During the year, the city implemented GASB 68, and that's a new reporting standard. And what that is the city is allocated its percentage of the state's pension plan. Now, all of the decisions regarding that allocation comes from the plan's administrators and not the city of Hickory. But you do report that in your financials. This slide shows a general fund summary of revenues and expenditures for 2015 as compared to 2014. You can see revenues increased as well as expenditures. We'll talk about some of these revenues and expenditures as we go further along in our presentation. Fund balance for the general fund for 2015, and it is also compared to 2014 and 2013. Both of these columns show total fund balance, and unassigned fund balance. Total fund balance is the much larger column, and that's because the city has a legally adopted capital reserve fund, and those reserves are included in the general fund for financial reporting purposes. So that's all consolidated. So that total fund balance amount includes the total capital reserve funds, while the unassigned fund balance is just the general fund. Our next series of slides shows some of the city's major revenue sources and major expenditure sources as compared to the previous year. You can see that ad valorem taxes decreased slightly. The collection percentage was 98.16%. Other taxes increased. Other taxes are made up mostly of your state shared revenues, your sales tax, franchise tax, telecommunication tax, things of that nature. Restricted intergovernmental revenue increased. Your restricted intergovernmental revenue is primarily federal and state grant funding, so that'll vary each year depending on what types of projects and programs that the city is using federal or state funding for. Our next slide shows license and permits, and you can see license and permits decreased slightly. I do want to point out that this revenue source includes privilege license, and privilege license have been eliminated by the General Assembly for the foreseeable future. So we went ahead and put another column over here so you can see 2015 without that revenue source. Public safety. This is expenditures. They increased for the current year. General government increased as well. And culture and recreation decreased. That was mainly a decrease in capital purchases. We have some information on the city's major enterprise funds. The city's major enterprise funds are water and sewer fund, transportation fund, and solid waste fund. Here we're showing you the total current assets, current liabilities, working capital, as well as unrestricted cash. Now, all of these numbers can be found in your audited financial statements, but we just wanted to put a presentation together for you for quick reference. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer those at this time.
Any questions?
Could you go back three slides? Okay.
Right there?
Yeah. Public. No, one, go back one more, please.
Here we go.
All right, I see that. It's just that. Thank you.
Certainly.
Well, I would like to say that the audit committee, this year, Mr. Guess and I met with the auditors. We had a private meeting with the auditors with management absent, so we could document that we asked the questions, asked questions of the auditors without management present, without that factor involved. I'm very satisfied with the way that we've made the transition from when Mr. Wood was the finance officer here for several years, and we made that transition well. I want to thank our accounting staff and Mr. Miller, and I do want to thank you for your interrelationship with the auditors in a cooperative and professional way, and I am sure we're going to get another certificate of conformance for our annual report. Yes, anything you'd like to add?
No, I just concur with everything that you've said. It's always a pleasure when we meet and to hear how cooperative our staff is and how well run things are. So I just commend our staff for the good job that they've done, always.
Thank you. We appreciate the opportunity to service the city's auditors.
Mr. Larry Pope has requested to be heard.
Mayor, City Council, Mr. Bear and Mr. Crown, thank you for allowing me to speak this evening. I will be very brief in what I have to say, and that is, I have been before you as City Council several times on issues concerning Hickory Public Housing Authority. I did the same thing during those meetings that I attempted to do in 2011 when I could not get Hickory City Council or the Board of Commissioners to hear me out about the misappropriations of federal dollars. Hickory Public Housing Authority is currently over $500,000 in debt to monies that they have to pay back to the federal government for misappropriations. I came before you a few weeks ago and asked questions that I thought you as the mayor and city council were going to ask at the special call meeting that you had with Hickory Public Housing Authority to discuss some of the allegations that were made by me to you concerning misappropriations. At that meeting, you had a council chamber full of residents, citizens, and others who were here to see what you were going to do. And the only thing that was done was nothing. You asked no questions of the chairman of the board. You asked no questions of the attorney that was present. And when I left here, folk were standing outside and said, they've got to go. And what I have said to you in previous conversations is, you continue as the mayor and city council to reappoint the same board members over and over and over again. In 2011, I was removed from the board because Ms. Richardson didn't want me back on the board because I had gone to HUD and told them about the misappropriations. They came in, did an audit and an investigation, and found that the allegations that I had made, they found to be true. I know that at one of your meetings a couple of months ago, the mayor said that we do not have citizens who volunteer for boards and commissions. And I know that attorney Kim Clark volunteered for the Hickory Public Housing Authority board. And I have also filled out in the last 6 months an application to be reappointed to that board. If you don't want honest people serving on boards and commissions, then you don't want me and you don't want attorney Clark. But I think that at this point in time, you need folk like us that's going to be honest and not have HUD to continue to come in year after year after year after year. And I know, Mayor, you were down at public housing today because I saw you on Channel 9 on the news. And I hope that at some point in time you will face facts that no longer can wrongdoing be swept under the rug. It has to be addressed. There has to be changes made, or the residents of Hickory Public Housing is going to continue to suffer. Thank you.
at the end of the meeting, I intend under under general comments, I intend to talk about the Housing Authority and the trip we had to Greensboro and the outcome of that meeting. We have a motion to approve the minutes of October 6th.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Zagaroli, second by Patton. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That's unanimous, and all members are present. Anything to be moved off the consent agenda?
It will be approved.
Second.
Motion by Meisner, second by Lael. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That's unanimous. I'll just mention under informational item, my expenses to the Ignition City Vision in Winston-Salem are presented on page 5. And that Ignition City Vision was the name given this year to the North Carolina League of Municipalities annual meeting.
Reaffirmation.
Did I skip second readings?
If you would go back to reaffirmation.
We have a motion to reaffirm and ratify on second reading.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Patton, second by Seaver. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That's unanimous. Mr. Burry.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Your first new item this evening is a public hearing, and that's to consider a voluntary contiguous annexation petition of almost 12 acres located at 3,000 block of Short Road. And I'll ask the city's planning director, Mr. Brian Frazier, to come to the podium and present that item to council prior to the public hearing. Mr. Frazier.
Thank you, Mr. Barrow. Mayor Wright, members of council, Mr. Barrow, Mr. Crone, good evening. Mr. Barrow indicated Cecil and Rachel Monday have come in with a voluntary contiguous annexation on Short Road in Southeast Hickory, just under 12 acres. The current development is vacant residential property. The current value of the property is $104,600. The proposed future development is an 80-unit residential apartment complex. The value of similar developments in the area, such as 29 North and Waterford Place, is approximately $5,200,000. And annexation is being requested by the applicants to obtain connection to our city's water and sewer system. You can see here the proposed area, the annexation, Tubba Valley Boulevard, Startown Road, Short Road. The blue is the existing city limits, and the beige color is our ETJ, the extraterritorial jurisdiction. The next slide shows the proposed area of annexation outlined in red. Again, Catawba Valley Boulevard, CVCC. Here's the Startown Road and the Fairbrook Medical Clinic right there. The next slide again shows the area of proposed annexation. This is the existing zoning. The yellow is low density residential, and blue is O&I, office and institutional, and the pinkish color is regional commercial. Next slide again shows Short Road, the area of the annexation. This is the HBC, Hickory by Choice 2030, future land use plan. You can see the blue is public institutional. That is the campus of CVCC. You can see the general business, regional commercial, and the low density residential, some medium density residential, but there's the property in question. This is a very early and preliminary plan of what would be known as Fairbrook Place Apartments, again, 80 multifamily units. This is building elevations of the proposed project, pretty similar to other styles of multifamily housing that we have within the city. And again, the voluntary annexation petition does comply with all annexation statutes. Public services are available in sufficient quantities and to serve the development. and the annexation itself will not cause any public services to fall below acceptable levels. We've already talked to our police, fire, and utilities folks, as well as public services. And based on these findings, the staff does recommend approval of the requested annexation, and you will see in future weeks an initial zoning, proposed zoning of the property, which will have to be through public hearings at both the Planning Commission and the City Council, and more than likely it'll be a planned development type of zoning, which would be fitting in the area and keeping in concert with Hickory by Choice 2030. With that, I'll end and be happy to answer any questions that you may have regarding this annexation. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. With that, I'm going to open the public hearing in a moment after laying out our general ground rules. We ask that first that people who are opposed to a proposal speak, and we allow 15 minutes. We encourage people opposed to divide that 15 minutes so that everyone is heard, but no one is going to be turned away and not allowed to be heard. Then we have 15 minutes for those who are speaking against the proposal, are speaking for the proposal, and then we have 5 minutes, 5 minutes of rebuttal and serve rebuttal to wrap up the public hearing. We ask for no cheers and jeers, and that we just allow the people's business to be conducted in a professional and in a manner in with adequate decorum. With that, I declare the public hearing open and ask if there's anyone present who would like to speak against this proposal. Is there anyone present who would like to speak for this proposal? There being no one desiring to speak, I declare the public hearing closed. And as you can tell, as has happened hundreds of times, I go through that long speech of how we're going to do things, and it doesn't. We don't need to say that. With that, I'd ask for a motion or discussion.
I move approval of the annexation.
I second.
Motion by Seaver, second by Zangaroli. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That's unanimous. The gentleman from Fayetteville, is that what you want to do here?
Yes, sir, it is.
I just met him right before the meeting.
Thank you very much.
Second new item is another public hearing, and I'll ask the city's community development manager, Mr. Dave Leonetti, to come to the podium. We have an offer to sell city-owned property, which is located on F Avenue Southeast. Mr. Leonetti.
Thank you. Mayor Wright, members of council, Mr. Berry, Mr. Crone. Tonight, I'm going to have a brief presentation prepared about the potential sale of 5 lots on F Avenue Southeast. They are located at addresses 865, 870, 872, 880, and 889. These 5 lots were originally purchased for future development and neighborhood stabilization and blight removal related to the East Hickory redevelopment plan. Staff has received an offer from AMCO LLC to purchase the 5 lots. Here, this slide shows the location. The properties are located just north of Tate Boulevard and just east of Lenore Ryan Boulevard on F Avenue Southeast. There's 3 contiguous lots that are relatively narrow. I think they're about 125, 150 feet deep that are contiguous along the south side of the road. And then there's 2 lots on the north side. The topography goes... It drops fairly quickly, so those deeper lots, there's not actually that much more that they can do than they can on the shallow lots, in all honesty. AMCO LLC, the folks that are offering to purchase the lots, own back to about here on the south side and back to this lot on the north side of the road. The properties were purchased with community development funds, so that requires a public hearing prior to the sale. And that sale also must be for market value. If the offer is accepted, staff must advertise for upset bids to ensure that the sale is also competitive. After a 10-day period in which no bids are received, the contract can be brought back to City Council for final approval. So these properties were recently appraised at for a total of $17,000. The offer from AMCO LLC is for that appraised value. And as I said previously, they own many of the properties between Lenore Ryan Boulevard and the subject properties. They plan to develop these for residential use. With that, staff recommends that City Council adopt a resolution accepting the offer from AMCO LLC and authorizing staff to advertise for upset bids. And with that, I would be happy to answer any questions.
Do you have a copy of the appraisal?
Not in my hand right now.
Who ordered it?
We did. I mean, I have a copy in my office.
You did? Okay,
yes.
So the city did order
the appraisal? Yes, the city ordered the appraisal, okay. Yes.
Well, you know, the upset bid process will absolutely establish the value. If the appraisal is just an estimate.
Correct.
You know their plan is for single-family dwellings or for apartments? Or
I believe they're for apartments. Well, technically, from what I've heard, it's sort of an apartment style, but they're actually large four-bedroom houses that are going to be leased individually to each individual apartment will have its own bedroom and bathroom with common cooking facilities. So it'll be sort of apartment style, but I believe they'll actually technically be single family homes.
Or like a dorm.
And this is for college use, probably.
Generally, that's what it's going to be marketed for.
It's nice to see the redevelopment. It's nice to see the redevelopment starting to happen.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Leonetti, unless someone has another question.
Thank you.
I'll declare the public hearing open and ask if there's anyone who would like to speak against this proposal. Is there anyone who would like to speak for this proposal? There being no one desiring to speak, I declare the public hearing closed and ask for motion or discussion.
Mr. Mayor, I have a couple comments. The tax value, which is generally our first go-to, which is less specific than an appraisal, is about twice the offer price right now. I've added it up. It's about $34,000 plus or minus. I'm not surprised necessarily that an appraisal might come in lower, but I don't know what a recent appraisal means. I don't know. It hasn't been done. You know, who did it? It sounds like we've ordered it. It was not included in our agenda packet. I just want to make sure that we're getting the full value out of the property. I certainly concur with Ms. Patton that it's great to have it redeveloped and all, but when I saw those prices, I was a little bit, I mean, $3,000 for a lot is pretty, I mean, that's just pretty low. And I know, you know, so, and I'm not suggesting, I'm just trying to get some confidence about that market value. That's and I'm just throw that out there. And maybe staff can it provide that through just, you know. Yeah, do you mind?
We ordered the appraisal back probably in August, and we got it back in mid-September, I believe. And Paul Henry did the appraisal, and that's those are the numbers that he came up with. So that was the basis.
Is there going to be any site improvements?
There'll be some grading done, I believe. I'm not 100%.
The only reason I mentioned that is sometimes that's a factor that maybe hadn't been considered in the tax value. But I certainly agree with Mr. Leo. We want to get the fair value of these property.
Yes, sir.
Does the advertising for upset bids, do you think that satisfies it?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. I'm not trying to be a, I'm not trying to be a stop to the project necessarily. I just wanted to make sure that we're getting, because we didn't have the appraisal in the agenda packet, and it just referenced a recent appraisal. And so, yeah, I mean, perhaps the upset bid does get to it. That generally will flesh things out, you know. And the other thing I'd say is, I think it'd be okay for us to say, if this is going to develop for student housing and is redevelopment, that we enter an economic development agreement and sell it to them if we agree to sell it to them for $17,000. you know. But if we're going to sell it just straight up, I just wanted to make sure it was, you know, well documented as to market value. It sounds like it is. So I have no further questions.
I'd rather get fair value than have an economic development agreement.
Yeah, well, that's, and look, I'm going to speed that either.
That's easier to explain.
Right.
It's very difficult to value raw land right now because building permits are so scarce that nobody's building. They're not paying market value for raw land. They're getting fire sale prices.
Makes you wonder what other properties they were comparing that to get their appraisal from.
Well, yeah, because there just aren't any
information
to lot sales
resource.
Well, appraisers in that case have to find something, don't they?
Well, it's
closest thing. Right.
I mean, you don't have the option to say there's no way to estimate the fair value.
It's relative to location, right. Too. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that was one of the prime areas of City of Hickory. So,
but it's going to be.
I understand. It's going to be.
We didn't have this problem 20 years ago.
No.
Just go around the neighborhood 4 or 5 blocks and see if you see any new construction, new residential construction. You don't.
No.
So it was hard to find anything to compare it to.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well,
I think putting it up for bid like that will, like you say.
I personally, I'm willing to live with the upset bid process. I assume people who are interested in developing raw land look for those kind of things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I don't believe you're even obligated to sell it if you don't get an upset bid. I mean, it's, you know, there's nothing that says you have to sell property, period.
Well, I think it's in our interest to sell it if we're getting market value.
And I sure would rather see developed property than,
right.
I mean, it's going to be 10, 15 years before that property is really developed. And they're using that to assemble property, you know, to tie in with their property. So.
Is this the last piece of property they need to get the project started?
Pretty much.
But there are other properties that they control or could get control of and do further development. And what I'm sensing is that's going to be, I'm sensing that whole area, it makes sense that area will become student housing. You've got the 90... The 90-some students are going to be going into the
PA program.
The PA, the Physician's Assistant Program, this would be an ideal place for them to rent and live.
Yep.
And it's not that far from the college either. They wouldn't have to walk as far to class as I did when I went to college. So,
Both ways.
Across the drill field that didn't have any sidewalks.
4 miles. Uphill both ways, yes.
Before the wheel.
And I didn't have boots.
Well, I think, as you say, the upset bid is probably going to tell us whether or not there's value in that property.
Yeah. I think a lot of people are going to be watching that.
Sure.
And I agree with Mr. Lill. I look at it, I said 17. There are factors that would make you think that would be reasonable. There are factors that make you think it should sell for a little more than that. I'm going to make a motion that we need to open a public hearing.
It was purchased with community development. No.
I'll put a second on it then.
Mr. Seaver was louder, so motion by Ms. Patton, second by Mr. Seaver. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That's unanimous.
Under departmental reports, I'll ask Mr. Mac McLeod to come to the podium and present a memorandum of understanding for construction of a splash pad at Kiwanis Park.
Good
You need no microphone. Go ahead.
14 years, that's the first time that's
happened. Just a little left. Thank you, Mr. Berry. Mayor Rod, members of the council, Mr. Berry, Mr. Crone, good evening. Tonight, for your consideration, is a memorandum of understanding for the construction of a splash pad at Kiwanis Park. As you know, the City of Hickory, the Hickory Kiwanis Club, and the Kiwanis Club of Western Catawba County engaged in a joint effort to construct the Czar Baker All Children's Playground at Kiwanis Park, which opened in May of 2012. And as you know, that is now it is now a destination point here in the city. 2015 is the 100th anniversary of Kiwanis International, and both Kiwanis clubs really desire to commemorate that anniversary through a local service project here in Hickory. So both Kiwanis clubs have agreed to partner with the City of Hickory to jointly fund the construction of a splash pad at Kiwanis Park that will be maintained by the City of Hickory as part of our operations. What I'd like to do is just briefly take you through the terms and conditions that are contained within the memorandum of understanding. As you can see, a splash pad management team is composed of representatives of both Kiwanis clubs and the City of Hickory will be formed to oversee project design and funding, fundraising, and from the City of Hickory, those representatives will be both city staff and representatives of our Parks and Recreation Commission. All parties would agree that the splash pad would be constructed at Kiwanis Park. The City of Hickory will determine the overall budget for the splash pad. Both Kiwanis clubs have agreed to contribute a minimum of $100,000 toward the construction of splash pads, and those contributions could include direct monetary payments from club funds, donations received by the Kiwanis Club, grant funds, any fundraising dollars, and any contributions made by the Kiwanis Club to the project beyond that initial $100,000 minimum contribution will be applied to the City of Hickory's funding obligations for the splash pad. The City of Hickory would deposit and give a receipt for all contributions that are made to the splash pad project. You can see by any individual, company, or organization, and then the Kiwanis clubs would receive credit of those a credit at a pledge amount of $100,000 for those contributions that do come in. And then that City of Hickory would hold all those contributions in a donations account. And then the City of Hickory will be responsible for the construction of the splash pad with all those expenses pertaining to design through construction will be processed through the City of Hickory. And should the Kiwanis clubs meet that $100,000 minimum contribution level, then they would receive naming rights to the splash pad. Once the splash pad is in place and the Kiwanis clubs have agreed to not, they would not maintain any rights regarding any future decisions that would be made, as you can see in operations, use, maintenance, improvements, alteration, or decommissioning of that splash pad. The memorandum of understanding that you have before you has been approved both by the Hickory Kiwanis Club and the Kiwanis Club of Western Catawba County, and I can assure you that both Kiwanis clubs are excited about this project and ready to get started. The Parks and Recreation Commission has considered and approved the memorandum of understanding. They did that at their October 13th meeting and recommends this approval by City Council. So staff recommends approval of the memorandum of understanding between the City of Hickory Kiwanis Club and the Kiwanis Club of Western Catawba County. for the construction of the splash pad at Kiwanis Park, and I'll stop there and answer any questions anyone may have.
Do we have some total cost of the splash pad?
I'm going to get to that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. I'm going to get to that in just a minute.
Are you going to ask? Are you going to talk about time frame too? Maybe a little bit. Time frame.
I can talk about that. We've really not gotten into exactly committing to a time frame as to when it's going to be on the ground. I've been asked that by both clubs, and I've not committed that because I don't want that. Basically, what we thought, we want to do it right the first time. So we want to get involved, but I don't want to commit to a time. We want to make sure we get everything right the first time. If that answers.
Also, what about the location at the?
I'm gonna handle that. We'll wait
till the end to ask more questions.
I've never seen so many enough questions.
Before I ask you, staff will ask for your approval on first reading of the memorandum of understanding. But before that, I would like to publicly state that, as you are aware, the city of Hickory has an ethics policy, and I'd like to read a portion of that ethics policy. States that city employees will avoid conflicts of interest and the appearance thereof. I have the esteemed honor of serving as the current president of the Kiwanis Club of Western Catawba County. I took office October 1, and I have the pleasure of serving as the president of that club through September 30th of 2016. As we started talking about this process and going through discussing with both clubs, it brought a question to my mind: is do I have a conflict of interest being an employee of the city of Hickory and also the president of the Western Catawba County Kiwanis Club? So I did ask Deputy City Attorney Arnita Dula for a legal opinion as to that fact, and she has concurred and has informed me that there could be an appearance of a conflict of interest. Based on that policy, based on the City of Hickory ethics policy, I did inform my immediate supervisor, Mr. Miller, that I did have a potential conflict of interest. Pending your approval of the memorandum of understanding, this is an exciting project for both the Kiwanis clubs and the City of Hickory. And I do not want there to be any distractions or any appearance of any distraction. I want everything to be completely transparent. So, pending your approval of the memorandum of understanding, and once it is assigned by all three parties, meaning the City of Hickory, the Hickory Kiwanis Club, and the Kiwanis Club of Western Catawba County, that I will step away from this project. And Assistant Parks and Recreation Director Don Andrews will then assume the lead role in this from the city's perspective. I've already discussed this and made the Parks and Recreation Commission aware of it. I've also made our club aware of this. Matter of fact, at our meeting today, I asked for their approval to allow our past president, David Parsons, to sign the memorandum of understanding pending your approval on behalf of their club. So, and they did, on behalf of our club. So they did approve that today. So I did want to publicly state that once that is signed, I just felt you needed to know of that potential conflict of interest.
Now did the deputy attorney say it is a conflict of interest?
There could be an appearance. It states, Mr. Mayor, the city board will avoid conflicts of interest and the appearance thereof.
Well, that's our policy.
Yes, sir. That's our policy. And based on her being there could be an appearance, and I don't want there to be any appearance whatsoever. So that's why
The reason I asked the question is, I certainly understand the magnanimous gesture that you're going to step away from it. But does that impose some standard on us and our other employees? That is it a higher standard than we ought to have imposed on us? Would there be parallels drawn between you stepping aside and some other employee or council member not stepping aside in a similar situation?
I can only speak for myself, Mr. Mayor. I can't answer that. I just feel as as my role with the City of Hickory Parks and Recreation Director, and then at the same time serving as the current president of the Kiwanis Club of Western Catawba County, I felt this is what I needed to do.
Well, I guess the only test is whether, and Mr. McLeod, I'm not trying to be argumentative.
I think
it's magnanimous gesture.
Yes, sir.
Is the only test that an individual says, I feel I need to step away? Is that the only test that needs to be met?
No, but I mean, there could be an appearance of a conflict if he's on a board that's entering into a contract with the city. And I think he's chosen the right thing to do, and I think he feels the same way.
I just worry about precedents. That's always what I worry about. And something coming back that you've never expected to haunt you. And someone say, well, Mr. Hanson didn't step down when he... I don't know why I picked on Mr. Hanson. But now we got his attention. Okay. Thank you, Mr. McLeod.
Thank you.
Yeah, it brings into question what I'm thinking too, that on the Hickory Kiwanis Club, but I'm not a member of the board that voted, so I don't know if I should be recused maybe from the vote on it or not. So I was thinking about that myself. Previously on the playground, it seemed more like a Kiwanis project in the city, but now it seems more like a city project since they're footing, or we as a city could be footing half or more of the bill. So.
My goal is just because I'm the current president of the Western Catawba County Kiwanis Club. That is the only reason why I did not want there to be any appearance of a conflict, solely for that reason, because of my role with the Western Catawba County Kiwanis Club.
You know, at the end of the day, not to beat this, I think Mac's doing the right thing, but at the end of the day, I mean, this is all those policies are about is somebody deriving some unjust gain, and this is not the case at all. Kiwanis has an implicit mission to do this kind of thing. The city, this is something the city wants to provide, so everybody's got great motives on this.
People who are going to gain the most are the children.
Oh, the children, right.
Yeah, but there's no financial. It's not like any investment or any way that money's going to find its way.
Or contract or anything like that.
And that's the reason I raised the question, you know, because we all understand that personal gain directly tied to a contract in some way is prohibited, pure and simple. We can't just dance away from that. We got to run away from it. But here, I just don't see how anybody, any reasonable person, maybe that's the key word, could say that there could ever be a conflict of interest over this. But at the same time, we understand, again, your magnanimous gesture. So I guess that's all we need to say about that.
Or David Parsons' magnanimous gesture.
Yes, sir. So staff would recommend your approval of the memorandum of understanding on first reading. Will I do that now, or I've got another presentation to take you through with that, whichever, if Mr. Mayor.
We need to go through
okay.
The rest of it.
That'll be fine.
An integral part of this decision.
What I'd like to do is just talk to you specifically about, this next presentation about some splash pad options. And I just want to start also, what is a splash pad? A splash pad is an area, as you can see, is an area for water play that is little or no standing water. In simplified terms, it's a playground that's got with water. tied to it. That is simply what a splash. You hear in our profession, splash pads, spray grounds. It's the same connotation both ways. You see, there's no need for lifeguards as there's little risk of drowning, and then the ground nozzles and water features are often controlled by hand-activated motion sensor to run for a limited time. That surfacing is either can be a textured non-slip concrete or poured-in-place rubber surfacing, which is the same. If you don't, that poured-in-place is exactly the same surface we have under the main unit at the Czar Baker All Children's Playground. Originally, when splash pads came about, they were really designed to appeal to young children, but really a more recent trend, you know, has been to design splash pads that include play features that appeal not only to the young kids, but teens as well as to adults. And what I'd like to do now, just to help you visualize what some different splash pads look like, I want to let you look at some that are already in various locations that are already on the ground, as we like to call it. First one, this is the splash pad city in Morganton. As you can see, that there are no overhead features at this. Everything comes from the ground up. If you'll notice the little yellow right here, the little yellow thing, this is the activation baller that basically this is what activates the spray nozzles. This is another shot of that same splash pad just from the opposite side. As you can see, this surface is a port. They have a port in place surfacing here. The next one, this is the city of Conover's. Basically the same type setup. It has no overhead water features. Everything comes up through ground nozzles. As you can see, this surface is a non-slip concrete. It has a concrete. This is another shot, and this is the green right here is the activation baller that activates the motion sensor for the water to The next one, this is a splash pad at the Hickory Foundation YMCA, and you see they reused and took I believe this may be an old wading pool and converted it into a splash pad. But you can see the difference here. These have overhead features as well as underground features. There's another shot of.
And the YMCA, it does have water. I think it goes up to
1 foot. Okay,
it does.
But they put it. These are spray features there. This is at the Adrian Schuper YMCA in Conover. As you can see, it has overhead features as well as features that come up through the ground. Here's another feature there, and here's their right there is their activation. Bollard there. This is one City of Kannapolis has it. I believe it's at Village Park in the City of Kannapolis, and it has overhead features and also through ground. And then the final one, this is one in Lincoln County. This is actually at Beatty's Ford Park, splash pad at Beatty's Ford Park. Last year, the Parks and Recreation Commission started to look at the splash pad development process, and part of what they were looking at, they asked staff to bring back to them some options, you know, different options to look at as potential, you know, splash pads here in Hickory. About that same time, both Kiwanis clubs started the process of talking about partnering with the city and developing a splash pad there at Kiwanis Park, and asked the same of staff, could you come up with some options for us to look at? So that's what staff did. And when we were going through the planning process with designing what the eventual product would look like for the Czar Baker All Children's Playground, we wanted that wow factor that when somebody comes up to it and they would say, wow, this is great. So we wanted to do that same, you know, same thing when we asked for these options to come forward. Before I get, and what we have, we had three options to, you know, for you to look at. So before we did, just wanted to show you where the proposed location is. This is an aerial of Kiwanis Park. Here is the playground. Right here is where we recently constructed the new picnic shelter restroom facility. If you come down to the what we call the middle section here, where we've got the playground, there's a picnic shelter, ball field here. Basically, the proposed location is right where the existing playground is now. What we did, I want to show you three, and these are options that we asked to look at. This first option, it has a nautical theme there. The total area that you're looking at is a little over 3,000 square feet. The actual spray area is about 2,100 square feet. It has nautical themes. When we were going to, as you can see here on this flag, we also incorporated the Kiwanis International logo. The color schemes you will see throughout these, we kind of tie in with what is already at the playground. This unit, this option has, there's 13 different water features there. Here's just two more views of that. That's just an overhead, just to show you the, you know, basically the layout of. So that's one option. Another option. This option features really the focal point of option two is right here, and this is called a super splash. It's a gigantic bucket that fills up, and as soon as it fills up to the point, it tilts right over and comes down, as you can see here. We've also, so the feet, this is the focal point. We incorporated the Kiwanis logo there. This has more separated of three zones. Like I mentioned, just as you design a playground equipment based on that different age groups, same thing can be done with a splash pad. So there's three different zones here, age-wise, from young kids all the way up to teenagers and adults there. As you can see, this is a little bit larger area. It's about 4,160 square feet total. The actual spray area where waters will actually hit is 3,003 square feet. And this option has 34 water features components with this option. This is just another look. You can see the super splash and the amount of water, you know, super splash there. Just to give you an overhead look, that's how an overhead look of that splash pad. The final option, this also, as you can see, it maintains the super splash as a focal point. The total area is just a little bit spaced out and zones a little bit more. The total area here is 4,456 square feet. The actual spray area where water hits the surface is a little over 3,200 square feet, 3,233 square feet. And there's three different, as with option two, there's three different play zones. There's also 34 water features component on this one. Taking option two and option three, there's nine like features that you would see on option two, option three. Then each option has different other features and different numbers of like features, but there are nine features there. Another look there. At that, and then as you can see, a little bit more standing of the, and you can see the three three zones there. Cost estimate consideration. The estimated cost for these three options ranges from $253,800 to $360,000. And these cost estimates do include contingency dollars, but do not include any infrastructure improvement dollars, meaning upgrading the water supply into the park. Staff, we can, you know, these are just options. We can pursue other options. We can add, you know, we can subtract from that, change the proposed size, the sizes that you see there. You know, any changes would affect, you know, our cost estimates. You know, both Kiwanis clubs are, you know, are excited about getting started, you know, with their fundraising efforts. You know, what we're asking for tonight is just your input on, you know, what you like, what you don't like, what you see there. We just want to get some feedback on these three options, and I'll stop right there and be happy to answer any questions anybody has.
Are there any laws or rules about how many people or children can be served by each of those?
Basically, each one of those can handle about 25 kids per 100 square feet, so about 250 on option two and three at any one time. That may seem a lot, but that's the number. That's the number of kids. Yes, sir.
Kids at one.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In one area.
Yes, sir.
We really have some big crowds. They're going to get bigger now. Mm-hmm.
And it's the same. You wouldn't imagine. You look at some of the playground equipment that's out there at the. A couple of the sphere out there, the Gallisphere, you know, that's a piece of equipment to handle up to 50, 60 kids. So, you know, it's based on a user based on square foot.
How much other undeveloped property do we have in that same location?
There's some on the.
I'm thinking about parking.
Yeah, I'm going to take you. When we built fields three and four, we built those back in 1996 and built. There's a parking lot back here, and one of the things we've done is we really don't open this parking lot. And there's also an access back over here on Third Avenue Drive. We don't open this parking lot. Only time we do that is when we have ball games going on. So right now, this parking lot is closed. Once the splash pad will be there, then all this parking will be available for the splash pad. We just don't use it right now.
There's sufficient parking.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That, now, granted, this will be like a ball game. You go down there on a ball game night, and we've got all four fields going. They park and line up along the street.
I agree with you, Mac, that we need the wow factor. The pads at Conover, Morganton, I think the wow factor comes from the overhead, which I know are more money. But I'm familiar with the splash pad down at the Marriott in Myrtle Beach, and the overheads really get a lot of play, and that's the wow factor in splash pads.
I mean, it would seem to me like the team, the Kiwanis with the city staff, I mean, they'll be looking in more detail, I guess, at all of these options.
Yes, sir. We're just here tonight. We wanted to get your input to take back to that team once they they've not formed yet. They're in the process until the memorandum of understanding was considered by council tonight. We're holding off bringing that team together. But we just wanted to bring this to you just to get your input that we could take back to.
I mean, this is unbudgeted for this fiscal year. It would be general fund dollars, so I would assume, if it would be constructed.
Well, does Council Rec have capital?
Yes, sir. If I could, that's a good segue, okay. Mr. Leo. I'd like to call on Mr. Miller. He'll address it. Okay, he'll address it. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mac, and Mr. Lale, for calling me to the podium. You're 100% correct. This is an unfunded project, and certainly we have plans for that. And I have told most, if not all, that we are planning a capital planning workshop on November the 3rd before your next city council meeting. We haven't determined location yet for that. To go over, this would be one of those capital projects that the city, you are all probably each aware of the other projects, to try to prioritize those and determine funding strategies and methods for each of those, this being one of those. This will be your first one. But as Max said, this partnership, and assuming Kiwanis, both clubs are successful, we have a $100,000 partner on our team, so to speak. So I think we are looking for the direction. I think, as Mac mentioned, we've got 3,000 square feet to 4,500 square feet in the three options he's outlined, 13 to 34 features. I think from our standpoint, we think we have the greatest option for the wow factor presented tonight. We wanted to make sure that we had the minimum option. Is that indeed option one? Is that the minimum size? You saw some of the other splash pad options in the region. Certainly, we want this to be a local amenity that's well attended by local residents, but we also see this as a regional draw. If you see the Conover, no offense to our neighbors at Conover, but if you see Conover's and Morgan's splash pad, you're going to want to go to Hickory's splash pad, if indeed some of these options are on the mark. So I think we're trying to look for, you know, Kiwanis is going to need to show some diagrams to folks as they're asking for donations, Mr. Siever being one of those. So we're looking for that range. Are we hitting the mark? What direction do we give this splash pad management team to go out and work out that fundraising strategy? I also said one of the council members asked, maybe it was Mr. Guest, about timing. Again, that will dictate, you know, how that fundraising opportunity, you know, goes for them. But at least this committee could be formed, and there, are they in that 15 feature range, or are they in the 30 to 35 feature range? Give them a range so that they can come back and work with Vortex if this company is one that's suitable to develop a design that is suitable for you, or at least in that range, so that they can bring that back to you with a recommendation or multiple recommendations. That's a lot to be said, but we're certainly want to hear your questions and or feedback.
How much money does Morganton have in theirs? Do you have any idea?
No, sir.
Conover said they had $60,000 in theirs. And as you say, that is a very basic splash pad. The only thing I really liked seeing was the sails in the background. But I didn't know they had.
Wonder where that idea came from.
But these smaller communities like Morganton, Newton, Conover, when they do a splash pad, they probably are not as likely to have to deal with the demand for more splash pads. And I think we likely will have to deal with people saying, you need to put one at this park or that park or the other park. And I'm afraid, I guess with this has become a regional draw park, and not just your local neighborhood park. And it, you know, we think it's convenient for people to access, but and it is. I don't want people to say, well, we got shortchanged on our splash pad. If they come to us and Mr. McLeod and his Parks and Rec group decide they want to do another splash pad, that's why I would kind of want to err on the side of starting. It looked to me like all of those had a wow factor. I'm personally thinking about, you know, what are the benefits of starting on the low end?
Well, one thing in lieu of that is that the Kiwanis group are going to raise $100,000. So that being said, if another group wants to come forward and say, hey, we too will do $100,000, then that lets us do a little bit more. But I don't want to just set that standard that this is the way it's going to be done.
I think Mr. Guest brought up a good point. I think the park has some constraints as it relates to parking. I mean, 250 kids on that particular splash pad, I mean, theoretically possible, probably not likely. But I do think that we could build a splash pad that's possibly too big, that's constrained maybe because people cannot park because there's ball games going on in the summer. People are using picnic shelters. So that was, when you got into that 4,000 square foot range, those things look pretty dang big. I mean, that's a lot of, that's a big area.
Well, I think if the fact, as you brought up, Rudy, that we may be looking at something like this in another area down the road, that this is not going to be end all and be all, just this location. I do know that I just finished a splash pad at Lake Hickory Country Club, and the wow factor is very, very important. And we have the tall things. The one thing I noticed in this particular one that is fabulous is the big bucket that drops down. And I think that would be something that would really put us different than a lot of other places, plus the other. So I'm kind of like you. I'm maybe in the middle at this point for this project, and then versus spending all of our money on a large one.
Well, I know all of us just want to say yes. We want to say yes. We want to see things done. We want them coming out of the ground, and we want everything to have a wow factor.
One thing I was impressed with, saw in Springville, Utah, my son lives there. They had something like a cement creek. Something, you know, kind of like the Science Center has, a little outdoor, the butterfly exhibit was, there's a little water thing there. My grandson loves to go in there and run boats. It's just a, you know, Springville had a lot of statuary around it. It was like a little creek running through there. No more than maybe 5 or 6 inches deep, just recycling the water through there. So, you know, I don't think that would be a whole lot to add to something, but kids love that kind of thing. Float things down.
I think that would be a nice touch.
Well, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the Friends of Hickory, their little splash pad is kind of like that. I think there's some running water through it and a few other things. So we will have another one downtown.
How many square feet is the Friends of Hickory splash pad?
I don't know.
How many is the Lake Hickory's Country Club?
What do you say? It's probably 30 by 30, 30, 30 feet diameter, maybe.
Almost.
They're just 10. 10 valves on it. So.
And what was the cost?
The cost of ours was $20,000.
That's a big difference.
Well, we already had the hole in the ground.
That's true.
It was the kiddie pool. So we just.
Did you put the resilient surface on it?
No, we did the poured concrete.
Poured concrete and then made it.
Yes, and then
made it skin resistant.
Yeah. And it's working out very well.
Kids,
we have not had any drownings whatsoever.
I bet they're cold tonight, Doug.
Yeah.
Well, you can drown in a teaspoon of water.
It's a 30-foot diameter, 40-foot diameter. Somebody who's a math major can figure out what the square feet would be.
Right. I mean,
what I would suggest, Mr. Mayor, is maybe that, or I would be inclined to move forward with the Memorandum of Understanding.
Yeah, yeah, right.
After they have their workshop, we'll have a better sense. We can make the decision within the context of some other decisions that we never come.
Agreed.
Yeah.
And then maybe explore some other options, because it seems to be such a wide range. I certainly don't want to do what Conover, Morganton, I do want that wow factor, but it seems there is, that's a real wow.
is this
big money.
Is this being put out to bid? Is it tomorrow?
Not yet.
Is it just the Vortex company is presenting this?
Yeah, sorry, it's the Vortex. We have a cooperative purchasing agreement with Vortex. The actual installation of the equipment will be put out to bid.
That will be put out to bid.
Yes, sir.
They're just the design.
Yes, sir.
Firm.
And that agreement, collective agreement, is through Charlotte.
It's a cooperative purchasing agreement. If I don't know who it's the NJJPA, and it escapes me right now. The joint.
But it's done by another government.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's
a cooperative purchase.
I want people to understand that they negotiate.
Yes, sir.
Prices based on higher volume, and so we get the benefit from that rather than our volume.
Is the
It's the old piggyback exception.
Yes. We would just bid out the actual installation would be bid out. Through our normal bid.
Some people might not know what we're talking about.
But I apologize for not knowing this.
Well, since my friend Charlie Dixon has spent so much time on this, and my friend Bill Wiggs is out there looking at me, staring me down right now, I'd like to make a motion. We approve this memorandum of understanding.
I'll second that.
Motion by Wright, second by Zagaroli. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That's unanimous. Thank you, Mr. McFadden. Appointments to boards and commission. I am pleased to announce that Catawba County now has a nominee, Mr. Jeff Curley, and we will advertise that and do that at our next meeting. We shouldn't just add one tonight, should we? I'm not absolutely positive. Commissioner Eisenhower said that they have Jeff Curley in multiple appointments. The International Council said 8 positions vacant. I'd like to point out they have 12 positions not vacant, so it's not likely. But they do have 8 positions vacant.
Well, that's not a 9-member board.
Any other comments or appointments? Petitions, requests, matters not on the agenda, general comments?
I have one, but I can wait till after you.
Well, you go ahead.
I just wanted to recognize and commend the folks at the fire department for the recent rescue and saving.
Oh, yeah.
That was a tremendous effort. I know that that's part of their everyday job, but that's what they train for, that's what they're there for. And I think that the 2-minute response was certainly admirable, not just for the 2 that made the rescue, but for our fire department in general, to say that we've got that kind of response. And we
saved a young man's life.
And the results from that, all the training and everything that y'all do all the time, that a lot of times doesn't get recognized, and we see what the results of that was, and it saved a man's life. Please let those 2 firefighters know that we recognize that.
Absolutely.
And when a police officer recognizes the fire department, that is a great occasion. General comments. I want to talk a little bit about our trip to the Hickory, to the Housing and Urban Development in Greensboro. What we've been doing to address the issues that have come out of a 9-page memorandum of allegations. I'd like to first say, if I may, as an old auditor, when I was told that there's been a misappropriation, I took that to mean a theft. And I hear this word misappropriation tossed around, and I have yet to see any allegations that involves theft. The reason this is getting so much attention from HUD, and I think maybe everybody here has heard that HUD is here today conducting an investigation, is because this is the second time that they've had to come down here and do some check some things out. We met Mr. Berry, Mr. Guess, Ms. Patton, and I went to HUD in Greensboro, met with the state director and several other key HUD officials, several representatives from Hickory Housing Authority and their consulting team, and Mr. Fuller, one of their directors, also went. What we heard is that they're going to come in and do an investigation. They told us it would be this week. And they are going to investigate all of the allegations of which they have become aware, and any more that they might become aware of. They give a no firm time frame within which they will communicate findings and recommended course of action. We learned that our authority, and I think this will shock you all, but this is what we've been dealing with this entire situation, is our authority and responsibility is to appoint the board members, reappoint, theoretically terminate board members, and we can dissolve the authority. And we were told specifically there's nothing in between. We do not have the authority to request to approve disbursements of non-federal funds. We were told that the House, HUD is reviewing federal and all other funds before being disbursed. I have in progress appointment of two additional board members. These are board members that I think would be would go in with no agenda. And I'm not going to address Mr. Pope's nomination, but I specifically addressed with Mrs. Clark, who I admire very much, and she is a very very outstanding citizen and a very smart lawyer. But I addressed specifically with her that she's perceived to have an agenda, and I need people, if I'm going to nominate them, there's some confusion about whether I nominate or appoint, okay? But if I'm going to nominate them or appoint them, whichever it is, I don't want to appoint somebody with an agenda. I believe that would be detrimental to the ongoing progress of the group. I was not in public housing today. I was interviewed by... I have never been interviewed by anybody anywhere within 5 miles of public housing. But I was interviewed at my work today. And I was interviewed by telephone. And just like I'm being with you, very open, very blunt about what we can and can't do and where we're going with this. I asked about appointing these board members, and the representatives of HUD said, hold off on that until we get through with what we're doing. That was their recommendation, and we're going to follow that. We have a board in place. I think they have the best interest of the neediest people among us at heart. And so it's not like they're without direction from a board. I've left out some things, I'm sure, but I feel strongly that we have handled this matter with the proper amount of attention, the proper lack of overreaction, and the proper sense that this can play itself out, and we'll deal with it as it plays out. Okay, unless somebody prods my memory, that's all I had to say.
I just think it was very refreshing to hear how frank they spoke with us about the issues and also the options that we do have at hand going forward. Once they do their investigation, that we then can discuss with them other options for the Hickory housing.
Any other questions or input?
Now, I appreciate your going down there, Mr. Mayor, and Councilman Guest and Councilwoman Patton. I mean, that was... I think you took time out of your schedules to go and try to get from a different, I know you've been to public housing authority meetings and tried to see, but to go down there to HUD and to ask the questions, I think was really wise, and I appreciate you doing that.
Well, thank you, sir, but I will tell you this, it was very informative for us.
Good.
And I think we're better able now to deal with this limited responsibility and authority that we have. But it's not as easy as people say. I know that there were people who calling for people's heads, and why isn't the council stepping out and doing this and that and the other? We don't have the authority to do it. We'd be breaking the law if we tried to. But we are watching to see if the time comes that we need to exercise in some way the limited authority we have.
I just want to reiterate that the director specifically asked us not to do anything at this point until they've completed what they're going to do, and that they will be forwarding that to the mayor, and at that point then we'll make our decisions.
That's it. Have we left anything out? I mean, I want the people here to know exactly what's going on as best we know. All right. Anything else? Any other comments? How did Oktoberfest go?
Rain.
Saturday.
Friday night.
How was it Sunday? That's Sunday. That's always wrap up morning. I was in South Carolina, and I had occasion to understand there from the newspaper and from signage how severe that flooding was, and we were very fortunate to have dodged that damage.
I'm kidding.
Anything else? Oh, Mr. Meisner, I wanted to ask you. You've been here 37 years. Has anybody broken the microphone and done
this? No, I believe you're right.
I thought that was probably
actually,
the first time.
We didn't have microphones for a while.
We had megaphones. Didn't you have megaphones?
Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Motion
from Guest. He was first, and Seaver seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
That's you now.
The word is
That's the only motion I made was to adjourn.